In 2020, America experienced the novel coronavirus, COVID-19, SARS-2. Americans saw an unprecedented amount of unlegislated mandates for restrictions, closures, and control. This is how it's affected one region in Northern California and is analogous to many in the country.
My name is Reinette Senum. I was raised here in Nevada County since I was 4 years old. I've traveled around the world a lot, lived in different places, Alaska, Utah, Los Angeles, but always Nevada City and Nevada County have been my home. And I returned back in about 2004 and became very disillusioned with politics, very concerned. And it was actually at that point in time that I decided to invest in something, and I decided to invest in my community, because I figured that if we're going to ever be facing challenging times, that I wanted to build this community as resilient as possible. And so I've been really just volunteering also on many different fronts. And then of course in 2008, I ran for City Council, was elected, became the vice mayor, then the mayor 10 years ago. And after that 4 year period, I took a 4 year break, thought I was done, and ended up running for re-election again, and I got re-elected, and I just finished my second term, and I also finished my second term not just as a council member but also as a mayor. And I had just actually completed my third election, and I won. And it was in July 8th that I was stepping down as mayor and was supposed to take my oath once again to begin my third term as city council. And instead of doing that, I actually read my resignation letter. And it was a very difficult thing to do because, as I said, I've really been investing myself in this community. And what happened was, and this was a long, hard process for me to go through to make this decision, but that began to happen actually before I was even reelected for my third term. It was in January that I became aware of coronavirus. I started, for whatever reason, it was kind of more intuitive. I was always aware of SARS in the past and MERS and H1N1, but these had never really worried me whatsoever, but this was different. I was seeing what was going on in China, so I made a point to get some Twitter accounts and Facebook accounts to see the personal accounts within China to see what was going on, and I was very alarmed. I was particularly alarmed by what I was seeing with the government's response. So I, in February 16th, I wrote an email to some of my dear friends and said, hey guys, you may or may not have heard of this thing called coronavirus, but I can tell you right now, politically and as far as supply interruptions and manufacturing and economic interruptions, something's on its way. And I sent that warning to the city council and the city staff and the county, and said, you know, start stocking up on goods and PPE and so on, because we might be needing it. And again, I don't know how deadly it was gonna be, but at that time, I was listening to the John Hopkins University updates every day, and they were saying that the infectious rate was going to double every 5 to 6.4 days. And according to my calculation, that meant that by the end of April, the whole entire world would be consumed with this virus. It seemed very scary. So played it safe, played it cautious and conservative. And in March, we decided to declare a state of emergency for the city of Nevada City. And as the acting mayor and director of emergencies, I signed off on that. And I did have questions, I did have concerns, but no matter what, I figured that at that point in time, we still had to really be conservative and be really safe. So I signed off on this emergency. And during those times, every single week on Friday, we would have our county Zoom calls, and I began asking questions, because at that point in time, all we really had originally was to go off of the predictive modeling, and those numbers were really quite frightful. And then as we started to roll along, I started asking more questions. Well, what are the consequences of these closures, you know, the cost-benefit analysis, unintended consequences, anxiety, depression, suicide attempts, successful suicides, and so on. The loss of income, of being able to provide food to put on your own table. And I kept questioning these things, and as I would do this, generally a couple different things would happen. Many times I'd just be muted, and just kind of delayed as far as asking the questions and deflected. And when I would ask more than two questions or three questions, I'd be told, listen, Reinette, too many questions. Why don't you just wait till the end of the Zoom call? And what we'll do is we'll answer those questions for you afterwards when everyone's off. And I get two people, three people on the Zoom call afterwards to just kind of give me some little quick little superficial answers. And basically these Zoom calls were never for me to ask any deeper questions. And the thing that was really disconcerting to me was nobody was asking the questions. We weren't really having any mayors or the CEO of the company asking any deep questions. And when I did ask some questions, for instance, which was, what's the end goal? What's the measurement here? What's the metrics that we're shooting for? I mean, like, when is enough is enough? When have we reached our goal? What is that? Well, basically, Reinette, until we have zero cases. And my answer to that was zero cases. When do we ever have zero cases of influenza or anything for that matter? And for how long? But what I saw was we had early draconian measures based upon the predictive models. But then what happened was the data was coming in that was not supporting those predictive early models, right? And yet we were on the exact same trajectory. When I would ask the director of the public health department about a mask mandate, he would say, well, due to my own personal observation, I don't think that's a good idea because I see people who are wearing their masks incorrectly. They're touching them, they're handling them, they're moving them up and down their faces, and basically it's creating a false sense of security. In fact, it's creating such a false sense of security that people are actually going out there and they're doing more dangerous things. They're not washing their hands and they're not social distancing. So I really don't support that. And then yet, on the official county website, he would never say that. So what that meant was myself and the other mayors of the cities would be in the streets trying to answer the questions of our citizens. And we'd say to them, well, this is what the director of public health is saying to us in the Zoom calls, which is like, no, I don't support a mask mandate because the public are not utilizing them correctly. They're not wearing them correctly. And yet there's a conflicting information on the public website. So what I also saw was it was an immense amount of misinformation coming from the state, from the feds, from the county, and from what I could tell, that was really almost by design and pitting people against people in this community. And then, here in Nevada County, we're a very elongated county. In fact, part of our county's on one side of the Sierra mountain range, and one's on the other eastern side. And it was the eastern side where we had one death. And there was also this amazing misrepresentation by the county on their COVID dashboard online. And that was, for many, many months, we saw this one big red one, like one death. And then we had all these positive cases. And of course, I noticed that the goalpost was always constantly changing by the governor. We saw that he had the secretive billion-dollar mask deal with the Chinese government and a Chinese automaker. 5 days after we get the OSHA certification, we have a statewide mask mandate, even though the numbers were not supporting it. And when that happened, that mask mandate, which seemed like was an amazing overreach of government, it was made by a governor, not through the legislative process, and there is a process to making laws and passing bills that also includes the public's input. That did not happen. And so I went to our police chief and I said, hey, can you actually enforce this mandate? And he told me it's unconstitutional from what he knows of, and there's no penal code to back it up, so no, they cannot. So when the mask mandate came out, I was absolutely livid. I knew it was an overreach of government, and that's what made me angry, is I was not discussing whether or not the masks were working. What I was discussing was the fact that this is an overreach of your governor. He does not have the authority to do this. But of course, it got put into the headlines of the newspapers. Oh, this mayor is speaking out against, you know, the use of masks. I'm like, no, I'm not speaking out against the use of masks as much as I'm speaking out against the overreach of your governor. And interestingly enough, I actually survived the arrows of the community, the arrows of elected officials, and I survived that just fine and was ready to start my third term. And it was at that point in time I stepped down. And when I read my letter of resignation, I ended it with this very important story. And that story was this, is that I have a hero by the name of Dr. Leonard Hardell. Dr. Leonard Hardell is a gentleman that spent years researching Agent Orange, and it took him incredible years of dedication and research to finally convince the World Health Organization that Agent Orange is a cancer-causing agent. And once they did that, and it was proven that it was actually a cancer-causing agent, at that point in time, they went out and started going after what they considered individuals, heads of corporations and so on, military, that were committing crimes against humanity by continuing to spray Agent Orange. And interestingly enough, there is one question and one question only that defines whether or not you are committing crimes against humanity. And that question is, what did you know by when? What did you know by when? And what I told my city council, and it was also speaking to the county supervisors and to heads of agencies and departments, at some point in time, we are going to come back and we are going to ask you, what did you know by when? And we're going to hold your feet to the fire, because what you are doing right now, you are committing crimes against humanity. And I then stepped down. And I stepped down so I could step up. And what I mean by that is that I realized that in order for me to call out these uncomfortable truths, I could not be in an elected position, because ultimately City Hall was going to be in the crosshairs, and they would be having to deal with all the emails and correspondence and people screaming, yes, we support her, no, we don't, back and forth. And they didn't have the time for that or the bandwidth for that. So I realized that in order for me to speak out towards truth, that I was gonna have to step down and do just that from the sidelines. And I've been doing it ever since. And so now today we are continuing on the same trajectory. The fear mongering is continuing. The lies, the COVID lies are continuing. We are right now political pawns in all of this. And this has nothing to do about health. If it did, we'd be changing our decisions according to the information that we're getting. But instead, we are literally on the exact same draconian trajectory that we began back in March, and we have not changed our ways whatsoever. As I say, there's a great saying, you cannot control the winds, but you can adjust your sails, and I'm actually asking the leaders of California to adjust their sails accordingly.